Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. Today we're going to be talking more about non-relativistic quantum mechanics. Last time we discussed the interpretation of the Schrödinger equation, we talked a lot about Born statistical interpretation, and now we are ready to begin the more mathematical part of quantum mechanics and to start actually doing something with it. So we saw that Born statistical interpretation told us that the square of the absolute value of our wave function gives us the probability of finding the particle between some x and x plus dx, so in some region dx. So what this means is that if we integrate this amount, the square of psi of x comma t dx, if we square this in the entire space, so from x from minus infinity to infinity, then our particles should be here 100%. There should be a 100% chance of finding our particle somewhere in space. You know, that should make sense, right? If we say what is the probability of finding the particle anywhere, it should be 100%. So this should be equal to 1. And this is very, very important. This is what is called the normalization of the wave function. And wave functions that satisfy this condition are square integrable, that we call them square integrable. And they are basically the ones that interest us, because if this integral does not converge, so if it has an infinite value, then that basically means that this is not an acceptable solution. This is not a physically valid solution. It may be mathematically valid, but it is not physically acceptable. So it has to be not infinite, and it has to be also not zero. So we have to find a way so that our wave functions are equal to one. So what is usually done is that we consider, since the Schrödinger equation is a partial differential equation, if we have a certain wave function of x, t, and if we know that this is a solution, then we also know that some constant a times the same wave function, this is also a solution, right? Because any linear combination of solutions is also a solution. And this is just some number multiplying this wave function. So what is usually done, and that's what we will do in a future video when we do an example of this, is that we have to find what is the constant of integration that we need in order to have our normalized wave function. Okay, well, the most important thing is it can't be infinity, it can't be zero. And if it's any finite amount, we can multiply by some constant so that this integral is equal to one and we can interpret the result easily. So that is that part. Now we must ask ourselves, what happens later? So let's say that at some point in time, we know that this function is normalized. But what happens later? Does it remain normalized, or do we have to constantly calculate to see whether or not this is normalized? So now we want to just take a look at this. So what happens to this expression? How does it change in time? So I'm going to just rewrite our expression right here, squared dx, and we take the time derivative of this, because as I said, we want to know what happens to it with time. The best case scenario is that this would be equal to zero. If that happens, that's amazing, because this means that this wave function does not, at least it is still going to be in space, it's going to be constant in time, in the sense that its probability is going to be constant. So this function is going to remain normalized. So hopefully this is zero, because if not, that would mean that we will have to continuously find this normalization constant and check if it is normalizable at all. So let's do this. In order to start, we must remember, if we have the square of an absolute value of a complex number, we can just rewrite that as this complex number or function as its conjugate times just this function or number a. So in our case, what this means is that this psi squared, I'm going to drop this x comma t for now. We know that it's a function of x and time, so I'm just going to drop it for now. So this is just going to be psi conjugate times psi. So I'm going to now insert this into my integral. So the time derivative of this integral from minus infinity to infinity is now going to be this right here, dx. So now I'm going to take this derivative into my integral. So we can do that because this integral is with respect to x, our derivative is with respect to time, so we can just reverse the order of these two. So we've got the integral from minus infinity to infinity, and I'm going to write them with the partial sign, just to emphasize that these functions have more than just one variable. So we get this. Okay, so now we're just going to take this derivative. Since it's a product, we have to apply the product rule for derivation. So we get the integral from minus infinity to infinity. And now we got the derivative of the first term, which is d psi conjugate dt times the second term, just psi, plus psi conjugate d psi dt, and this times dx. Now, here we, what is this amount? What is d psi dagger dt? Now, here we're going to use a trick that is quite commonly used in quantum mechanics. If you didn't think of this, do not worry. I don't think many people think of this the first time they encounter this, so don't worry. But now we're going to just go back and take a look at the Schrödinger equation. So what was the Schrödinger equation? It was just I h bar d psi dt. This is equal to minus h bar squared over 2m d squared psi dx squared. This is obviously in one dimension. Later we will talk about more dimensions, but it's basically the same form anyways. Plus some potential times psi. This is the Schrödinger equation. And if you see on the left side, and this is why we're doing this, we got this d psi dt term. So let us now find this term, which is basically just divide by I h bar. So we get that d psi dt is going to be minus h bar, one of these cancel out, over 2mi d squared psi dx squared. And we got here the second term, which is just a potential times psi divided by I h bar. So now we found d psi dt, and this is the trick that we wanted to use, because now we know this term right here, but we don't know d psi conjugate dt. So in order to find that one, we are just going to take the complex conjugate of this equation right here. So d psi dagger dt. This is, well, here we got an I, so we have to change that minus sign to mi, and this is now d squared psi conjugate dx squared. And now instead of plus, this is going to be minus v psi I h bar. Okay, so now we got these two terms, so we are just going to write them into our integral right here. So let's do that. I'm going to move this apart a little bit. This two, okay. So instead of this first partial derivative, we are now going to write this one right here. So h bar over 2mi d squared psi conjugate dx squared minus v psi i h bar. And this entire thing is now multiplied by this psi that was left outside. So now we do something similar. Oops, I dragged this line. I didn't want to do that. Okay, so now we have to write this d psi dt. So our expression for that is right here. Oh, I wanted to have a red line, sorry. Okay, so that is just minus h bar over 2mi d squared psi dx squared plus v psi over I h bar. And that's that term. Okay, so now we made quite a bit of progress. This is usually the most complicated step, but all we did, let's go back a little. We took this time derivative and then we said we got to this expression right here and we couldn't really go any further because we need something to work with instead of this partial derivative with respect to time. And now we got something in common here. Oh, wait, I made an oopsie. This right here should have this conjugate sign. Okay, so now you can multiply these, and because this potential is a scalar, we are going to see that this term cancels out this other term. Now you can just do the multiplication. It just comes right away because this, you can just write this potential to the left of this and it's going to be canceling out right away. So what do we get from this after that one cancellation? We can factor out this h bar over 2mi, and we get this derivative squared with respect to x conjugate, and then it times psi, and then we have this term right here, so we get minus psi dagger d squared psi dx squared, and this entire thing dx. Okay, now comes another pretty common technique that we use in quantum mechanics, at least in these kinds of demonstrations. I'm going to take this into the next page. If you need to copy, you can always just pause the video. So what we're going to do now is we're going to take a look at this and we say, they both got these dx terms. We can't just factor it out because the order is not right. But let's just see what would happen. We have to now look at an expression. This is sometimes, it can feel a little weird, but it is commonly used because we know where we want to get to, so we use kind of a little trick. So we're going to take a look at the following expression. We are just going to take the derivative with respect to x of not just this quantity, but of the following one. So it's going to be basically the same, but we took one of these derivatives out. Now it's not just factoring one out, because as we see, there is an extra term, but we will see that it will cancel out. So let's just look at this and see if it happens to be the same as what is in here. So let's take this derivative. I'm going to write it down here, actually. So when we do that, we get this first one, we get a product rule here. So we get second derivative of psi conjugate dx squared times psi plus now the derivative of the second term. So that would be d psi dx. And now we got this, the derivative of the second term. So we get minus d psi conjugate dx times this other one, plus, but there's already a minus sign in front, so we have to keep that, minus psi conjugate d squared psi dx squared. So what do we have here? Now we got the exact same term here, and these cancel out. Okay, so what we are left with after we cancel this out is just this. And this is exactly the same as this right here. So the whole point of this was just to show that we can rewrite what is in here. As I said, if this is the first time you have seen, you are seeing this, don't worry too much if you don't think of these tricks. These are used quite often, so if you once you start seeing them, you'll start thinking of them, but I don't think that many people think of them the first time they encounter one of these problems. So let us now write this in there. H bar over 2mi minus infinity to infinity of the partial derivatives with respect to x of the psi dx minus psi, whoops, this is supposed to be an x, dx minus psi conjugate d psi dx dx. So now we got an integral with respect to x of a derivative with respect to x. Now, because of the fundamental theorem of calculus, this is just going to be our function evaluated at the endpoints. So this is going to be h bar over 2mi times this function in here, psi minus psi d psi dx, between minus infinity and infinity. This is evaluated between minus infinity and infinity. And this is zero. Why is that? Because both psi and psi conjugate have to go to zero when x goes to infinity or when x goes to minus infinity. Now, why is that? Let us now make a quick drawing just to make sure that you comprehend that, because it's very important. Let's say that we have some wave function, right? This is just the probability, there it is, the probability squared. This is our x. So our function has to be a square integrable. It has to be normalizable. And for that, it has to have a convergent integral. When you integrate the probability function, it has to be convergent. So that means that when this probability, when the x goes to either infinity or minus infinity, the probability must go to zero. The probability of finding it there must go to zero, because if it doesn't, then this is just going to go like this somehow, or up, or I don't know, and you are not going to get, this is not going to be a convergent integral. That is why when we get this form right here, we see, okay, we have to evaluate psi and psi dagger at infinity and minus infinity, but those have to be zero. For physically acceptable solutions, that is zero. That is why this entire expression is zero. And if we remember, this entire expression is just the time derivative of this probability of finding the particle in some point in space. So the whole point of this was to show that if we have a wave function that is normalizable and is normalized, it will remain normalized forever. And that is amazing for us, because that means we don't have to be finding new or normalizing it again. So that is very good. So that is it for this part. We are going to do an example in the next video of normalizing a few functions. So stay tuned. I'll see you there.